Hello students of class 11th, how are you? I hope you all are fit and fine. So dear students, let us continue with chapter 8, Silk Road in Hornbill, written by Nick Middleton. As of now, we have seen in this chapter that the narrator, the protagonist, this chapter is a journey to Mount Kailash. It's a journey of the narrator to Mount Kailash. Mount Kailash. Okay? It's a journey of the protagonist to Mount Kailash to complete Kora. To complete Kora. Kora, you know, is a meditation which is performed by Buddhist. Okay? So, dear students, we have seen that the narrator had to come across many challenges on his journey to Mount Kailash. So we have seen this. As of now, we have seen that the narrator had to come across many challenges on his way to Mount Kailash. Sometimes he was suffering with cold, he was not feeling well. Sometimes the turns were very short. Sometimes the snow was very hard. The road was full of snow. So thus the narrator came across many obstacles. But on the other hand, he was also coming across many new experiences, as he saw many things, different animals like gazelles, wild ass, mastiff. When he reached Hor, the town, it's a place on his way, it came on his way, to Mount Kailash. So when he reached Hor, he did not found the place as he read in the book and as he had heard about the place. And there he was suffering with great cold. He was taken to a hospital where he found the doctor was not in proper paraphernalia. He was not equipped with he was not having the miscellaneous equipment, like he was not wearing the uniform doctor. He did not have stethoscope. Even though he checked the doctor's pulse and gave him the medicine, as the narrator protagonist could not sleep that night. But when he was given the medicine, it worked and now he could sleep. He was feeling now better. Okay, so let's see what happened next in the story. So dear students, please open page number 78 and page number 79, not 7, okay? Look at page number 79, till 78 we have finished, okay? So when narrator reached to medical college in Darchen for his medicine, so he was given medicine by the doctor who was not, you know, wearing any miscellaneous equipment, was without miscellaneous equipment. I asked him, look at the second last paragraph of page number 79. I asked him if he thought I would recover enough to be able to do the Kora. Oh yes, he said, you will be fine. The narrator asked the doctor if he would be able to complete his Kora. Then doctor, yes, he will be fine. I walked out of the medical college clutching a brown envelope stuffed with 15 screws of paper. So narrator walked out of the medical college clutching, having a brown envelope which was filled with 15 screws of paper. Screws of paper, you know, when you visit any doctor, you must have seen, they give you medicine in you know, pudia. So that pudia is screws, okay. They wrap it in a paper. So the tablets were wrapped in a paper, that is screws, that were screws. I had a 5-day course of Tibetan medicine which I started right away. So the narrator had 5-day course of Tibetan medicine and he started from that day. I opened an after breakfast package and found it contain a brown powder that I had to take with hot water. So after breakfast, when narrator opened one of the screw, he found it was a brown powder that he had to take with the hot water. It tasted just like cinnamon, and that medicine tasted just like cinnamon. Cinnamon, you know, dalchini, it is called dalchini in Hindi, cinnamon. The contents of the lunchtime and bedtime packages were less obviously identifiable. So medicine which the tablets which he had to take after lunch time and bedtime, they were a little bit different. Both contained small spherical brown petals. They were having small spherical brown petals, means student tablets, pellets means tablets. Pellets means tablets. Okay. So they were having brown spherical tablets. They looked suspiciously like sheep dung, but of course I took them. They were looking like sheep dung, even though the narrator took them. That night, after my first full day's course, I slept very soundly. So that night, after taking his first full day course, he slept soundly like a log, not a dead man. Like a log, you know, when you keep a log, it does not move. So like that, the narrator slept soundly. Now page number 80, paragraph 1. Once he saw that I was going to live, Satan left me. Once he saw that I was going to live, Satan left me to return to Lhasa. So once Satan found the narrator was getting well, Satan left for Lhasa. As a Buddhist, he told me he knew that it didn't really matter if I passed away, but he thought it would be bad for his for business. He, as a Buddhist, he told that if narrator would pass away, if narrator, you know, would have died, so it doesn't matter for him because he was a Buddhist, but it may affect his business. Darchen didn't look so horrible after a good night's sleep. So earlier he was considering the Darchen a very dull place, but now after a complete sleep he found it a little interesting. It was still dusty, partially derelict. Derelict means, you know, ruined. Derelict means ruined. Ruined. Derelict means ruined. And punctuated by heaps of rubble and refuse, but still it was dusty and heaps of garbage could be seen here and there. But the sun shone brilliantly in a clear blue sky, and the outlook across the plain to the south gave me a vision of the Himalayas. But the sun was shining well and he could see Himalayas. He could enjoy the scene of Himalayas. Commanded by a huge snow-capped mountain, it was covered by snow. Gurla Mandhata, with just a wisp of cloud suspended over its summit. Gurla Mandhata was just it can be a peak of the Himalaya. Okay, he said Gurla Mandhata with just a wisp. Wisp means a small amount of something. Wisp means a small amount of something. This means a small amount of something. So he said further, a wisp of cloud suspended over its summit, over its peak, over its summit, a small amount of cloud could be seen covering it. The town had a couple of rudimentary general stores selling Chinese cigarettes, soap, and other basic provisions, as well as the usual strings of prayer flags. So rudimentary means basic or primary. Rudimentary means basic or primary. Basic or primary. So the town had a couple of rudimentary general stores selling Chinese cigarette, soap, and other basic provisions. So he said the town had a couple of shops, general stores, which were selling Chinese cigarette, soap, and other basic provisions, as well as the usual strings of prayer flags. In front of one, men gathered in the afternoon for a game of pool, the battered table looking supremely inconscious. Inconscious means, strange. Inconscious. So it sat in front of one. So men gathered for afternoon for the game of pool, and battered table looking supreme in conscious in the open air, while nearby women washed their long hair in the icy water of narrow brook that babbled down past my guest house. So your narrator describes the scene, how people were gathering to play a game of pool in front of a provision, and the women were washing their hair in icy water in the small river. Brook means small river, which was flowing just under the narrator's guest house. So narrator describes the scene in Darchen. Darchen felt relaxed and unhurried, but for me it came a significant drawback. It came with a significant drawback. Narrator tells us that the people, you know, were not in a hurry in Darchen. It was slow, but for the narrator, it has no great significance. It came with a significant drawback. It was the drawback. There were no pilgrims, because there were no places where the narrator could visit. There were no pilgrims in Darchen. So that is why it was a dull place for narrator, because there were no pilgrims in Darchen. I had been told that at the height of the pilgrimage season, the town was bustling with visitors. The narrator had been told that the height of the pilgrimage season, when many visitors visit there, when it is the time of pilgrimage to Mount Kailash, so the town was bustling with visitors. So a lot of visitors, they go there. It's a bustling of visitors, as the narrator had been told. Many brought their own accommodation. So many of them, they brought their own accommodation, the place where they can stay, the tent type thing, which they can, you know, pitch in any place and can stay. Enlarging the settlement round its edges as they set up their tents, which spill down to the plain. So they used to set up their tents, and they used to live in those temporary house during pilgrimage, when a large amount of people used to visit there. I had timed my arrival for the beginning of the season. A narrator came there in the beginning of the season, but it seemed I was too early. Narrator's scheduled was in the beginning of the season, but he found that he was too early. One afternoon, I sat pondering on options over a glass of tea in Darchen's old cafe. So one afternoon, the narrator sat thinking. Pondering means thinking. Pondering means thinking. Pondering means thinking. So the narrator sat thinking his options over a glass of tea in Darchen's only cafe. So he was, you know, pondering over. One afternoon, he sat thinking his options over a glass of tea in Darchen's only cafe. So there was only cafe in Darchen where the narrator was taking tea and thinking, planning. After a little consideration, I concluded there were several limited, severely limited. So after little concluding, he found that it was strictly limited. There were no, he had no much opportunities to visit anywhere in Darchen, as there were no pilgrims in Darchen. Clearly, I hadn't made much progress with my self help program on positive thinking. So if positively, the narrator tells us that if he would talk about his consideration of plan, so it was the conclusion that he could not, you know, plan it a better way. He could not plan his journey in a better way. Clearly, I hadn't made much progress with my self-help program on positive thinking. So narrator, it was his self-made program, but he could not, plan it very well. Okay. In my defense, I had been easy with all my sleeping difficulties, but however I looked it. So narrator, it had been easy with all my sleeping difficulties. Now his sleeping difficulties were easy, but however I looked at it, I could only wait. Even though he had to wait, he was now feeling better, but even though he decided to wait, the pilgrimage trails were well trodden, but I didn't fancy doing it alone. So the pilgrimage trails, the pilgrimage path was well trodden, much frequented by. So trail was much trodden means much frequented by. Well trodden, frequented by. Much frequented by. But I didn't fancy doing it alone. But narrator did not want to do it alone, to do his journey on foot alone. He wanted a company. The Kora was seasonal because parts of the route were liable to blockage by snow. So the Kora was seasonable. The Kora was seasonal because most of the months, in the most of the time of the year, it was blocked by snow. So that is why it was opened only for some months. So it was seasonal. I had no idea whether or not the snow had cleared, but I wasn't encouraged by chunks of dirty ice that still clung to the banks of Darkens Brook. So he said, I had no idea. The protagonist had no idea whether or not the snow had cleared. Whether snow had cleared, but I wasn't encouraged by chunks of dirty ice, but he was not encouraged by chunks. Chunks means, a thick solid piece of something. Chunks means a thick solid piece of something. Chunks means a thick solid piece of something. So here, a thick solid piece of snow. Okay, so I wasn't encouraged by the thick solid piece of snow and clung to the banks of Darkens Brook, which was holding the banks of Darkens, the banks of rivers in Darchan. Since Satan had left, I had come across anyone in Darchan. I hadn't come across anyone in Darchan with enough English to answer even this most basic question. So when Satan left, since Satan had left, narrator had not found anyone in Darchan who could answer, his basic questions in English, who could understand English. The narrator did not find anyone in Darchan who could understand English and could answer him in English. Until that is, I met Norbu. So it was until he met Norbu. Now he met a person whose name was Norbu. The cafe was small, dark and cavernous. Cavernous means vast. Cavernous means vast. Cavernous means vast. So the cafe was small, dark and vast, with a long metal stove that ran down in the middle. With a long metal stove which was running down in the middle, and the walls and ceiling withered in sheets of multicolored, wreathed. Here, student, wreathed. Wreathed means twisted. Wreathed means twisted. Wreathed means twisted. So, dear students, once again, until that is, I met Norbu. Until the narrator met Norbu, so there was no one who could understand English and could answer his basic questions. The cafe was small, dark and cavernous, with a long metal stove that ran down in the middle. So narrator found the cafe vast and a metal stove was in the middle of it. The walls and ceiling were wreathed in sheets of multicolored. So the walls and ceiling of the cafe were twisted in sheets of multicolored plastic of the stripped variety, broad blue, red and white. So he was, here describing the cafe in which he was taking tea. So that is made into stout. Voluminous means very loose or fall. Voluminous, can you see? Yes. Voluminous. Means very loose or fall. Voluminous means very loose. Very loose or fall. Okay. Having much fabric. Can you see? I will show you. Voluminous means very loose or fall, having much fabric. Have you written? You can also take the screenshot. I hope you have taken. Okay. So that is made into stout, voluminous shopping bags sold all over China. So it was made, you know, from very loose and having much fabric. Such shopping bags which are sold over China and many other countries of Asia and well in Europe. As such, plastic must rate as one of China's most successful exports along the Silk Road today. Even today, China exports such bags which are made with much fabric. Still today, China exports them along the Silk Road, even today. So the narrator describes the bag which he saw in that cafe. It was loose and it was having much fabric. It was made in China, and that bag still it was exported along the Silk Road today. So using Silk Road, still China exports those bags. So thank you students for watching the video. In my next class, I'll finish this chapter and I'll also discuss question answer of this chapter. Okay, so thank you students for watching the video.